Okay, looks like people are starting to join us. Welcome, everybody. We will get started in just a moment. Well, we're welcoming in all the attendees. If you'd like to jump in the chat and let us know where you're dialing in from, that would be wonderful to see what our audience is like. It's always difficult for us on the other end of the camera, not seeing everyone's face. So please do jump in the chat and let us know where you're from. We'll get started officially very shortly. Jenny, I'm very much liking your username, Melbourneilia01. Great to see you here. Hey, Bram from Gembrook. Couple more minutes and we'll be kicking off. Hi, Robert. Nice to have you here with us. Thank you. If you're just joining us, we're just kicking off in a minute. Please do jump in the chat. Let us know where you're dialing in from today and where you're watching this incredible Reimagining the City Challenge from. Okay, and we are about 60 seconds away from kicking off this event. Greetings from West Melbourne, from Gippsland, from Footscray, all over Melbourne and beyond. I suspect we've even got some audience interstate and overseas, so it's great to have you all here. Okay. Phil, Emma, where shall we get going? Ready to rock. Absolutely. Well, welcome everybody out there in internet land. My name is Jeanette Chia and welcome to the Reimagining the City Challenge with the City of Melbourne. It's an absolute pleasure to have you in the Zoom room with us tonight as we're going to go through some incredible innovations and you're going to have a very special part to play also in tonight. As part of the emerging tech testbed of the city, it's all about serving the community and that's you. So before I get started, I have asked you where you're dialing in from. I'm dialing in from Brunswick, and I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. And I'd like to pay my respects to elders past and present, as well as any traditional owners in the room with us here tonight. I'm so excited about the chance to talk about this challenge and to sort of be part of the event because I just absolutely love Melbourne, as I'm sure many of you do. In the role that I have, I get the chance to travel around the world pre-COVID, and there's always something very special about coming home and having that first sip of a long black from a great Melbourne cafe. And so I'm very excited and very grateful to every vitalist here tonight that they've had the chance to spend time with us working with their innovations to make our city even better. So let me tell you the plan for the next hour and a half. Of course, we're going to have a bit of a welcome and an overview of this incredible challenge. You're then going to get the chance to hear from 7 finalists who have been handpicked and put through the ringer in terms of all of the different things that they're working on. Everything from using your body as a controller to imagining the knowledge that we have here in the city. There's some incredible innovations coming up. We're then going to have some voting where we'll actually pick a yellow jersey winner for the evening. And we'll talk about the next step. So hopefully that sounds okay to all of you and we are going to get going. I'll tell you a little bit more about the voting first because it's a really exciting opportunity and it's probably the first time we've engaged the community so directly in this particular challenge. Your vote will count for 20% of the overall chance of the winner and the emerging tech testbed, as I said, is driven by the desire to support the community, which is why your voice definitely counts. And it's not only going to count tonight, but you'll have another 2 weeks after this event to cast your votes and to get your community involved. So please do warm up, jump in the chat, tell us where you're from. I want to hear from everybody. And while we're doing that, just letting you know a little bit of housekeeping. You'll see down the bottom of your screen, there is a closed caption option. So if you do want to see a live transcript, you're welcome to click that button and have a look at the transcript as it goes. And for all of those people who are out and about, we do have live recording going on and we can see you. So watch your backgrounds and make sure that we don't see anything that we shouldn't be seeing. Please do also drop your comments in the chat section. We love to hear your engagement and do ask any questions in the chat as well. There will be a number of people from the 25H team and the council team available in the chat. So there's Phil Orr, who's here with us. There's Kim Fernandez and Emma Van Small, who will be in the chat, alongside the wonderful Tegan Kopp and Heli Kostasek from the City of Melbourne Council. Guys, did you want to unmute and say hello to everybody?
Hello.
Hi.
Hi, everyone.
So great to have you here. And so for everyone else, please do remember just to keep on mute just so we can ensure the quality of experience for everybody else. And we will kind of press the button for you if you forget to do so. And finally, you know, just a little bit more of reminding that this is a wonderful, inclusive, diverse event. It's a community event. So we've got zero policy for any Zoom bombing, any kind of behavior that we don't like. Please don't bring your llamas in. I know that Zoom bombing with llamas is definitely a thing that happened early in the lockdown times. Okay, so I think we're going to start with a quick poll. Emma, you have a poll to share with us. Is that right? So we're going to find out what's actually bringing you to the event tonight. Please have a look and select the thing that's bringing you to tonight's event. Whether you know someone pitching, you just love Melbourne, you want to learn a bit more about tech. Click the button and hit submit. And whenever you're ready, Emma, you're very welcome to share those results.
Just got a few more coming in.
Beautiful. Thanks for sharing, everybody. It's great to see all the answers coming through. Now, for me, you know, I do know some people pitching. I love Melbourne, want to hear about technology, and it'd be great to see what everyone else says. Okay. So we've got the biggest response from people that work in technology, data, or smart cities, and that's a fantastic result. So you're obviously here to look at the new ideas and see what's coming through the pipeline. I'm really, really excited to have you, as well as 27% of people supporting someone they know. So that's fantastic. All right. Thank you, Emma, for that. I'd like to now officially introduce our first speaker for the evening. So Councillor Philip Lelou from the City of Melbourne, he's here to officially welcome everyone to this event. Councillor Lelou was elected in November 2020, so you know, what a time to join the team, having previously been elected in 2016. So been around taking care of Melbourne for a while, we really appreciate that. He's a portfolio lead for finance, governance and risk, and the deputy portfolio lead for education and innovation. So safe to say he's a busy man. I know he's very passionate about technology and very passionate about a great latte. So Councillor Lelou, over to you.
Thank you, Jeanette, and good afternoon, everyone. Councillor Philip Lelou, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this pitch event. Let me begin by respectfully acknowledging the traditional custodians of the land, the Burrumbung, Wurrun, and Wurundjeri Wurrun people of the Eastern Kulin Nation, and pay my respects to the elders past, present, emerging. The City of Melbourne is committed to our reconciliation journey because at its heart, reconciliation is about strengthening relationships between Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal peoples for the benefit of all Victorians. May I also acknowledge online with us today, my fellow Councillor Jamal Hakeem, community members and judges, current emerging technology testbed partners and City of Melbourne colleagues. Welcome all. Look, I'm so pleased that today we'll be hearing outstanding ideas designed to accelerate our city's recovery. The City of Melbourne's emerging technology testbed has a proud history. The test beds was originally set up in Carlton inside of MID or Melbourne Innovation District, City North, to explore how a local government can best collaborate with industry partners to through a shared optimism about modern technologies. We asked how can we maximise the benefit of our community through sharing data and investigating emerging technologies such as 5Gs and Internet of Things. And just reading recent articles, we should even start talking about 6G now and many other things coming forward. So far, we've backed a number of proposals around using data and sensors to improve life for all who visit or live in our city. In transport, in our streets, and in our parks, pilot projects are already underway and helping us understand activities within this vibrant city of ours. And we've created new opportunity for business right here in Melbourne. So what will this year bring? Well, that's the $1 billion or $1 trillion question that everyone wants to try to solve. But in 2021, we will count on you more than ever. Our entire community is climbing out of what is a disastrous year for business, the arts, and every sector in general. Recovery depends heavily on great ideas and energy. Deploys swiftly. Technology provides many opportunities to get us there. But overall, for me, technology at the end of the day is just an enabler, but it's also about the people that actually drive it. Because without the people, it's very, very hard to do a lot of things. Melbourne is a dynamic city, constantly thinking innovative way to anticipate and meet the changing needs of the community, the economy, and the environment. To address the unexpected impact of COVID-19 and pandemics, many of you have questioned assumptions and reimagined innovative approaches. This year's Reimagining the City Challenge focuses on recovery and reactivation across the city, while also imagining what the future will look like. Our shortlist has been selected from 40 submissions. After the finals pitch, the ideas tonight, there'll be a two-week community voting period. Winners will be announced in April. A pool of up to $180,000 is available to support up to 4 pitches, and the winners will work with the City of Melbourne's Emerging Technology Testbed to progress their pilots. It has never been more important to pilot and test data and technology approaches in relation to the city challenges, and I personally thank you for your interest and enthusiasm. Tonight, I wish we could meet in person, but we all have to accept that we now have to Zoom. I note that Zoom is now going to be in the Macquarie Dictionary or something like that, where it's a word. I never thought I would ever say that, but it is quite important. But nevertheless, technology again is the solution that helped solve a problem, and Zoom has helped us connect with each other today. And look, just before I end, one thing that's very passionate about myself, and because I'm an entrepreneur myself, I would also encourage everyone to visit the open data sets on City of Melbourne. So City of Melbourne has numerous data sets for startups and entrepreneurs so that they can get the data they need to test their theories and assumptions. So if you just go onto the City of Melbourne website, Google the open data set, and you'll find, and the most that we ever use is probably parking. So we've got a lot of parking data. So for any of those people out there interested in parking startups, it's one of the key things that we've actually put forward. However, nevertheless, I just want to say thank you again. Best of luck tonight, and hope we can actually see some great things.
Thank you so much, Councillor Leloux. Funny you mentioned parking data. I suspect one of our finalists might have plenty to say about that. And I also agree with you, this concept of having Zoom as not just a noun, but a verb. Whoever would have thought, but thank goodness for it, because without it, my business would have completely gone and we would have been one less small business in Melbourne. So that's not what we wanted. Lovely to hear from you. And it gives me wonderful pleasure to now hand over to the beating heart of the Emerging Technology Testbed, the lead at City of Melbourne, who's worked tirelessly to get this amazing initiative together for the future of Melbourne. Tegan, over to you.
Thanks, Jeanette, and thanks, Councillor Leloux. And it's not just me, it's a whole team of people just the lucky person who gets to talk about it today. So as Jeanette mentioned, my name's Tegan Kopp and my pronouns are they, them, and I work at the City of Melbourne as the Emerging Technology Testbed Lead. Before I begin, I'd just like to say that I'm beaming into your screen today from Melbourne, and I want to respectfully acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land, the Bunurong Boonwurrung and the Wurundjeri Woiwurrung peoples of the Eastern Kulin Nation, and I want to pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. We are so, so lucky to live on this land where innovation has played a part for tens of thousands of years. I would also just like to quickly pay my respects to any other elders past and present of other communities who might be joining us today. So, why are we here? Well, we all know that technology and data are increasingly playing a part of our daily lives and continue to change the way we work, live and play. And we only have to think about how hard it would be to do life without a device and an internet connection to see these impacts. Since 2018, the City of Melbourne has been proactively working with telecommunication carriers, hardware and software companies, local businesses, startups, academia, community and community members to position Melbourne's economy to benefit from digital disruption. And the result has been Australia's first locally government-led emerging technology testbed function. Really, this is just a fancy government technology way of saying that we at the City of Melbourne have worked out a way to work together with lots of different companies and everyday citizens to test and learn about emerging technology and data and how it might create a better Melbourne. This includes running city challenges like the one tonight. The testbed function really just allows us to get a better understanding of how we can use emerging technology to address city opportunities and problems such as sustainability, transport, safety and economic activation. And then we're able to share our learnings across Melbourne, across Victoria and Australia, and even globally. This is really a relatively new way for local governments to pilot and test emerging technology. As a small, humble brag, this is why in late 2020, the City of Melbourne Testbed was one of three finalists in the Enabling Technology category at the World Smart City Awards. And we're really proud of that. Lots of cities around the world, including Melbourne, already use technology and collect data to create better city experiences. As Councillor Lalu just mentioned, we have an amazing parking data set. And at City of Melbourne, we have lots of really well-established smart functions like our smart bins, smart parking and pedestrian sensor network, which really help us to understand waste, vehicle and people movement through the city so that we can create really much better city experiences. Through the testbed function, we are focused on exploring emerging technology to build on these impressive citywide projects and so that we can continue to build the digital maturity of our city and continue to create those really great city experiences that Melbourne's really famous for. We've got two pilots running right now through the testbed function, and you can find out more about these on Participate Melbourne, and we'll link that at the end of this event tonight. So we've got the City Circle Tram pilot, which is a partnership with Yarra Trams and a local IoT provider, Active Reactor. A microclimate sensor has been installed on a tram to help us understand how temperature and humidity impact the comfort of passengers and Yarra Tram employees at tram stops. We've also got a pilot at Argyle Square, which is an end-to-end Internet of Things park. And that's in partnership with Amazon Web Services, Citywide, Pecklet Technology, Fourier, Mesh, Smart City Solutions, and University of Melbourne. And a range of sensors have been installed in Argyle Square to collect data to help City of Melbourne understand park activity. And that's the park activity of the animals, but also the environment and the humans. The data collected is really going to help us improve the Argyle Square park experience, and learnings might be applied to other parks and open spaces in the municipality. But these pilots are really focused on creating better experiences, but it's very behind the scenes. It's like good design. You don't notice when things work, only when they don't. This is very important work to do, and it's work that we'll continue to do, but we know that sometimes it can be hard to connect into these types of projects to everyday life, which is why we're all here, to reimagine the city and vote for projects that are tangible and exciting for the people that love Melbourne. We do this because we know when applying technology to community-focused problems, we can get great results that everyone can understand and benefit from. The challenge tonight that we've asked the seven finalists to respond to is, How might we reimagine experiences, spaces and places so that they are vibrant and inclusive, promoting social connection and creating new reasons to live, work and play in Melbourne? As Councillor Lulu mentioned, the 7 finalists pitching tonight were whittled down from 40 submissions. And if being successful in being selected, we'll have the opportunity to pilot with the Emerging Technology Testbed team, which includes me, right here in Melbourne. And I just wanted to say a massive congratulations again to all the finalists and good luck tonight and over the next 2 weeks of community voting. Over to you, Jeanette.
Thank you, Tegan. That was amazing. And you know what? The favorite thing that you just said that I heard was about the collaborative partnerships, you know, between everyday citizens, businesses, local government. I think, you know, in times of scarcity and times of challenge, you know, they lead to sort of really creative partnerships, and you guys have been absolutely leading the charge at City of Melbourne, and it's just wonderful to see. So thank you so much for that. I'm particularly excited to see how we get the animals now involved, given we're tracking the animal data. That could be a very interesting next step. Okay, so as Tegan mentioned, the winner of this competition will receive their requested amount from a pool of $180,000. And if there's a little left over, second place might get a look into. The winner will be decided as a combination of 80% of our incredible judges and 20% community voting on Participate Melbourne. Such an incredible chance for the people of Melbourne to really have a say, a genuine say in what gets tested and created for our city. Now let's quickly go through this criteria, because just so you know what we're judging on, and as the citizen voting, you might want to know what you're judging on as well. We are judging on to what extent the pitch articulates the problem or opportunity area and the response. To what extent does the pitch address the challenge statement? Does it really embody Melbourne's future aspirational values? You know, does it get the spirit of Melbourne in there? Does it also demonstrate the team's capability to deliver? So how strongly can we trust that that team is going to be able to get done what they say they're going to get done? And to what extent does the pitch leverage the data and technology that's available to them to deliver an innovation? So that's what we'll be judging on, and it's very exciting. So keep that in mind as you cast your votes later in the night. It's now time for me to introduce our judges who have kindly been here to give their expertise and will be helping to that 80% vote decision. And I'm going to throw to them individually to sort of talk a little bit about what they're working on and you know, what they're looking for in the pitches. So I might start with Monitha Bonney, the founder and mentor and coach and speaker. She's a thought leader. She's all about loving Melbourne's food and experiential culture. So Monitha, would you like to unmute and let everyone know what you'll be looking for tonight in the pitches?
Hi everyone, welcome to this incredible session. I can see lots of beautiful faces in the audience. So my main area of expertise is around diversity and inclusion. And so I guess one of the areas that I will be specifically looking at is how inclusive are the ideas to accommodate for the diversity that is within the City of Melbourne. And there are many other areas that we'll be looking at, as mentioned in the criteria as well. And I guess the other thing is intention. So you know, what is the deeper intention of the work that you are doing and the impact of that on anyone that comes within the City of Melbourne?
Thanks, Monitha. That's really great to see you here and to get your expertise in the judging. Now I'm going to move on to Aisha Dani, the founder of Sistervate. Wonderful to have you here also. Aisha's all about loving Melbourne's European vibe. You know, it's got that kind of European feel without all the complexity. So we'd like to unmute Aisha and tell us, what will you be looking for in the pitches this evening?
Thank you so much for that, Jeanette. I'm super excited to be here tonight. My key experience basically is around scaling up operations. So the two things that I would be really looking for tonight is the potential scale of the impact of your idea. And most importantly, I guess, given the COVID circumstances, is how your idea is going to increase engagement of the community in Melbourne, whether they are the entrepreneurs, you know, the business, and also the creatives. Thank you for that.
Thank you. It's so important to think about scale and how it's actually going to move from, you know, serving a niche to maybe moving to beyond that. Wonderful to have you here. Thank you so much. Next on my slide is the wonderful Imogen Lewis, Development Director of Development Victoria. Imogen, also agrees that Melbourne has something for everybody, no matter what your niche is. Imogen, would you like to tell us what you're looking for this evening?
Yes, thanks, Jeanette, and hi, everyone. So as mentioned, I'm a development director with Development Victoria. I work on large-scale precinct-type projects that seek to revitalise large areas of the city, and we are always looking at ways to innovate and bring new thinking into our projects. So tonight, I'm looking for ideas or initiatives that have an immediate practical application that will deliver tangible, measurable benefits for the city and the community to help us recover from the last 12 months. Thanks. Looking forward to it.
Absolutely. And isn't that a recovery we are all very desperate for? Thanks, Imogen. The wonderful Liam Gilligan, apologies, is here. Liam is dialing in all the way from Sydney. So he's a digital innovation manager at the City of Sydney. I saw in the chat earlier someone saying we don't want spies from interstate, but we have one right in our midst. Liam, would you like to tell us what you're looking for in the pitches apart from that roar of the footy that you can only get here in Melbourne?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. I guess a few things I'll be looking for. One, just good use of technology to solve real customer problems. I think that'd be really interesting, and particularly anything that's impactful in that kind of revitalization effort. And I'm also really interested in anything that's kind of, scalability or transferability of interesting technology.
Thanks, Liam. Really, really great to have you here, and thanks for contributing to your sister down south, or the city down south. Now, our final judge is the incredible Michelle Fitzgerald, Chief Digital Officer for the City of Melbourne. Michelle's love is simple and finite. It is trams. Michelle, would you like to tell us a little bit more about why you love trams and also what you're looking for tonight out of the pitches?
Thanks, Jeanette. I don't know. They're just such a Melbourne icon. We've got the largest tram network in the world, and it's something to be proud of. Look, thanks so much, Jeanette. I just want to, first of all, thank and acknowledge all of our finalists, everyone else who applied for tonight's pitch, everyone who's joined us in our audience, and, of course, to our wonderful team at City of Melbourne and our councillors. We could not be here without any of you today. What I'm looking for, so I work with Tegan and the team behind the scenes, and we're the ones who will be partnering with tonight's successful winners, in terms of actually implementing these solutions. We are actually going to implement these great initiatives in the city. So for me, it's about two things: doability and measurability. And the measurability is really important for our community. How will you measure success? And is it actually practically doable? Thanks, Jeanette.
Thank you so much, Michelle. And how exciting for you and the team to know that you're actually going to get your hands on some of this technology after this event. Okay, now we are going to get straight into the pitches, all the stuff you're looking forward to. But before we do, we have a really quick poll for the audience. We're curious about your understanding of tech and its relation to the City of Melbourne. So thank you, Emma, for starting that poll. And if anybody wants to choose whether you're, you know, not very techie or you're all about it, you eat, sleep, breathe, tech, let us know. And we're very curious to understand who our audience is and what it's made up of. I have to say, when I first started working in startups, I was probably on the moderate and interested vibe. But I think, you know, the more you immerse yourself into things, the greater your understanding gets. So it's been very, very cool journey the last couple of years, getting closer and closer to tech and startups. Emma, whenever you are ready, we can show the results of that survey. Okay, so we are all about, we're mostly like, you guys are pretty switched on. All right, this is your world. I guess that's why you're here and why you're choosing to spend your Thursday evening hanging out with us tonight. So thank you so much for filling in that survey. We are going to get straight in to the pitches. So I'm going to stop this share, and Emma, we're going to let you start with the videos for the very first one. Sorry, I did that wrong. We have coming up first, we've got the incredible Bonnie Shaw. So Bonnie Shaw is the Chief Strategy Officer and co-founder for Place Intelligence, and Bonnie's team, Norian, Sean, Ben and Paul, and their incredible long list of partners will be presenting the first pitch. So Emma, over to you for that video at your leisure.
How do ideas shape a city? That's the question we're going to explore with our proposal for the City of Melbourne's Urban Technologies Testbed Grant.
Hi, I'm Bonnie Shaw, Chief Strategy Officer and co-founder of Place Intelligence. We're a big data analytics and location intelligence startup proudly headquartered in the City of Melbourne. we've developed machine learning tools to harness massive data sets that unlock insights and drive evidence-based planning and design. We work all over the world to deliver place-based analytics about how people use places over time and why, to support evidence-based planning and decision-making that unlocks value and creates better places for all. We bring our expertise and advanced tools to power a collaboration with some of Melbourne's most significant institutions, the State Library of Victoria, Australian New Zealand School of Government, the University of Melbourne, Federation Square, the Science Gallery, RMIT University, and Melbourne Museums. The City of Melbourne celebrates these institutions and the wider Melbourne knowledge sector as the city's economic powerhouse, which has also deeply influenced the culture and physical layout of our city. This sector has been rocked by the effects of COVID-19 and the 2020 lockdown, resulting in serious economic downturns for Melbourne. And so together with our partners, we bring you our proposal for the knowledge that shapes Melbourne, to understand how the incredible knowledge and ideas contained in each of these institutions is picked up by people and carried around to shape the city. How does the idea of a triceratops stomp through the streets untethered from the museum? Where do the memories of Ned Kelly's armor rattle once they're liberated from the State Library? How do the stories of the eel traps told by Victoria's first people in the Bundjalaka Aboriginal Centre overlap with the ancient waterways that still flow under the streets of modern Melbourne? Where are the provocative concepts of perfection that the Science Gallery explores reflected in the windows of our shopping arcades? We aim to reimagine our collective understanding of Melbourne from the perspective of how our vital knowledge institutions shape our city. We'll do this by using a range of privacy-compliant activity and geographic data sets to model the activity of the knowledge sector, revealing hidden patterns of how people interact with the city's major institutions over time. Then we'll connect this vast model to the open access databases and digital archives of these knowledge institutions to reveal the ideas and inspiration that people come into contact with at each place. From the deep place-based knowledge of our traditional owners to the globally renowned medical breakthroughs of the Melbourne Biomed Precinct, we'll map how these ideas interact and collide and tell the multi-layered data stories that have shaped our city over time. This data will be dynamically rendered and visualized in beautiful and engaging animations to create awe-inspiring visuals, which will be displayed at a mighty scale across the digital shard at Federation Square, in the digital bricks at the New Science Gallery, across digital billboards throughout the city, and via large screens at our partner institutions, and of course online, ensuring that this engaging spectacle is accessible and will attract vast audiences to visit and move around the city. Not only will this project create an exciting interactive event for Melburnians, but the visualization is underpinned by an accurate data model of the real macro patterns of activity of the Melbourne knowledge sector over time, which can be a vital tool to inform strategic planning and policy efforts to support Melbourne's economic recovery. So, if you like the idea of supporting a strong economic recovery for Melbourne, a big, bold, dinosaur-sized takeover of the largest digital screens in the CBD, and revealing the hidden patterns of ideas that shape our city, please vote for our project, The Knowledge That Shapes Melbourne. We look forward to sharing this knowledge with you.
Incredible. What a start to come up with. Thank you so, so much, Bonnie and team, for presenting The Knowledge That Shapes Melbourne. Now, this has definitely hit close to heart for me. I work with the university sector and have seen firsthand some of the tough times they've gone through. So I'm going to throw over to the judges for some questions. Judges, would you like to unmute? I'm going to ask Michelle perhaps to ask the first question and Imogen after that. So maybe Imogen first, actually, if you're ready.
Sure. Thanks, Bonnie. That sounds like a really unique initiative and something that, you know, would be great to see come to fruition. You mentioned specifically that the initiative will help act as a vital tool to inform strategic planning and policy efforts, I think it was, to help Melbourne's economic recovery. Can you just expand on that a bit and just provide further insight as to how you see that occurring?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And thanks everyone for joining tonight. One of the ways that a lot of our clients use our mapping and modelling is to understand the relationships that audiences have with institutions and with places. And so we're able to provide really accurate models around the activity of particular places. And what we're proposing with the model for this project is that we'll also be able to demonstrate the relationships between some of these really important knowledge institutions, which will start to help both the institutions themselves, the city and state government, if they're interested, how these organizations are collaborating or potentially competing for audiences, where they come from at a macro scale. Obviously, we never get down into the individual mapping of people. It's always keeping the data at a high level of macro patterns, but we can show very clearly the patterns of how people move around and what attracts them to the city, which is becoming an increasingly valuable tool for planning decisions.
Thank you, Bonnie, and thank you for the question. I think we have maybe a minute left for one more. So Michelle, I might throw to you if you had a question for Bonnie there.
Thanks, Jeanette, and welcome, Bonnie. It's great to see you. Thank you for your pitch. I gave everyone a couple of clues about where my questions would be coming from. So this one's about doability. Really keen to understand how you'd be promoting the experience. So it's one thing to have it available, but it is a digital tool, so we need to make people aware of it. What are some of your thoughts around that?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've brought in a range of partners that are the managers and owners of some of the largest cultural institutions in town. They'll all be working with us around connecting in the digital archives to our model so that we're creating these really beautiful animations of their content. And so together we'll be promoting that through their channels to their communities, which I believe will have a pretty extensive reach, being some of the largest cultural institutions in the city. And then we'll also be creating large events. So the model and the animations will be displayed at Fed Square, at the Science Gallery, and on large screens at each of these institutions. So there'll be a really public activation that we'll be promoting for people to come and engage with, as well as making it available online. So we'll be hoping to draw people into the city to come and experience it, but then also making it digitally accessible as well.
Thank you, Bonnie, for that great answer. Now, we are probably a little running out of time for your time, but I'm going to give you just a few seconds to maybe do a pitch to the people watching. Why should they vote for you? I know you talked about the triceratops and everything. Give us your final pitch at the very end. One line. Why should we vote?
I'm so excited to see how ideas move around and shape the city. I think that's just going to be wildly interesting, and really excited to see how things like the triceratops that the Melbourne Museum's about to open with moves around the city carried by people as inspiration.
So you're appealing to our imagination. I really like that. And I love the eels on your screen there, Bonnie. Thank you so much to you, your team, Nori and Sean, Ben, Paul, and all of your wonderful partners for that pitch. Congratulations on making the finals.
Thanks so much. And best of luck to the other participants.
Wonderful. Okay. Now we're moving straight to the fabulous Aliza Levy, urban planner. And leading social spaces, a team that is with Andre, Don, Reese, and Cameron. And I'm going to stop the share and let Emma put up your incredible video. And I'm very excited to hear how spaces can be changed so they're more inclusive and they're safer and socially connected, particularly in the time of COVID-19. Emma, whenever you're ready.
Hi, my name's Aliza. I'm an urban planner and avid people watcher working with Inhabit Place, a tool that monitors and measures the human experience of public space. I'm representing the Social Spaces Collaboration. Just like public space, our team is diverse, pooling different skill sets to explore a solution. Our team includes big data analytics from Altimeter, public space design from Spark Furniture, fabrication from Roland Metalworks, and landscape consultancy from Tate Network. We're here to understand how public spaces in the city have changed through COVID and to pilot a tactile response that addresses our new needs. We see the role of public spaces in fostering social connections as central to a society's well-being, and we know there is untapped potential in the spaces we already have. Many of us are familiar with the new experience of hesitating to share a seat at a tram stop, or the frustration of picking up a takeaway in an effort to support our favourite CBD diner, but not having a place to sit and eat it. Too often, public spaces are designed without a deep appreciation of the human experience. We as a community adapt to what we're given, and we make it work as best we can. As designers and planners, we must be better equipped to learn from the people we design for. So in this challenge, we propose to pilot a data-driven design process where we observe and consult, distill those lessons, and deliver a place-specific physical solution that makes it more joyful and more social based on the feedback of those who know it best. Our work is showing, and studies from around the world are corroborating, that while we might be returning and moving through our civic spaces again, we're no longer stopping to spend time. It can create a sense of social isolation where we feel invisible to those rushing around us, and means we are less and less exposed to each other's differences. Yet we know that the act of routinely seeing others that are different from ourselves makes us more empathetic, more trusting, and our communities more resilient in times of upheaval. Public space is the perfect stage to build this trust, but we need new opportunities to feel a part of the city. By interrogating data from before and during the pandemic, we're going to find out what types of spaces have continued to be visited and investigate whether they're providing the community needs we have in this post-COVID environment. Putting people on the ground to observe and interact with the place, we will gain a deep understanding of the public experience. We're going to ask you, the community, as you move through, what works, what could be better? We will listen, and in response to your feedback, pull together a tactile place improvement that can be on the ground within 4 months. We will monitor and measure the impact it has and to what extent it addresses the needs you raised. It's a community-led design exercise to pilot an approach to public realm delivery that is human-centered. The value of the social spaces proposal is that it trials a data-driven design process that can be repeated easily, offering the city a new method for ongoing monitoring and public space improvement. It delivers a tangible outcome, making the most of an existing public space. It provides something the community can interact with, free of charge, with no device required. And ultimately, but most importantly, it offers a social benefit, a community coming together to contribute to a shared outcome. We emerge from behind our screens into what was once considered the real world, where we remember what unites us, whether that be a table to balance a takeaway dinner, the chance for play, a safe space to sit and talk. You tell us, what do you want?
Thank you for that presentation, Aliza, and congratulations also to your entire team, Andre Lodovic, Don Shuffles, Reese Alexandrick, and Cameron Johnson. Now we're going to throw to our judges for some questions. I might start with you, Alicia. Aisha, would you like to ask a question to the team?
Hi, and thank you so much, Aliza. My question for you and your team is, what does success look like for social spaces? It seems that it's very open-ended by soliciting the information from the community and also measuring how they're moving through the space. But what does it look like ultimately for you and for your team?
Yeah, lovely. Thanks very much for the question. I suppose for us, success would be being able to demonstrate a change in behaviour and changes in visitation to that public realm. So we're all about engaging in an existing public space, improving the amenity and improving that experience. It's about creating social connection. What I referenced in that video is the studies suggesting that we're moving through our spaces again, but we're no longer stopping to spend time. And we know that taking that moment to pause is where we have the opportunity to interact with one another. And it also slows down the community to interact with the commercial venues that are around us in the city, and encouraging people to feel comfortable to spend time so that they can be in the city for longer durations and engaging with new users in that space.
Amazing. Thank you for that answer. And I'm going to now invite Liam. Would you like to unmute and ask a question of Aliza and the team from Social Spaces?
Yeah, for sure. Thanks, Lisa, for the presentation. The pitch was really good. One of the challenges, I guess, with designing for public spaces often is very differing views from the public about what the space should be used for. Have you got any thoughts around how you would kind of, I guess, address or build, gain consensus in kind of use of the space?
Yeah, absolutely. And we've got quite a lot of experience working in public spaces, eliciting emotive responses around what the community wants. I might also throw here to Andre from Spark Furniture, who's done some really great examples of how we observe people's experience in public space. We pick apart what the why is behind their behaviors so that we can apply a really creative design response to their needs. Often people will respond with certain measures that they already have seen in other experiences, and it's our role as designers to come in and absorb that information and respond in a creative manner. I don't know, Andre has some examples from work that they've completed also in Melbourne.
Thank you, Eliza. I'll keep it short. Thanks. I will use an example, which is probably you're aware of the ball that's going up everywhere in Melbourne after the stuff that happened on Swanston Street, and we were engaged with a landscape architect to design a bollard. It was not just a bollard, it had to have a lot of social interaction as well. So we came up together with them to design a seat that now people are actually using. It's actually on at the RMIT building, building 100, I think, the one with all the discs. I think everyone will know it. And there's a bollard sitting next to it that does not look like a bollard. It's being used for very much social interaction. And I think that's a way we'd like to see something like that potentially happen. What that may be different, but we know that we can deliver something that's really cool for the public.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Andre, for sharing that idea. And I think we all do remember the bollards and the amazing creativity that came out of the city when that happened. I'm going to allow the same courtesy to this team as I did to the previous. Would you like to give us a little bit of a 10, 20 second, why should we put our vote towards social spaces?
Yeah, absolutely. So for us, it's really about improving public spaces. So we know public space is a really central part of how the city of Melbourne operates. People move through. It's a space that we can socially connect with others that's free of charge. We're mindful of creating accessible spaces that are inclusive and wanting to operate in a physical capacity so people have the chance again to come together in a way that makes them feel safe in this new environment, but also delivers opportunities to improve our city and create public spaces that are targeted to the context of their environment.
Thank you so much for that. I think in the last 12 months, public spaces have been one of the only places we could get together with our friends and family. And so, you know, to really sort of adapt to that is really fascinating. So thank you so much for the pitch and for the wonderful answers. Okay, we are going to move on to our very next finalist. This is one for anybody that's into gaming, perhaps. Danny Smith, BDM over at Sage Automation, he reckons that we might be able to become a controller. So his team at Swinburne and Nucon have backed him up here. I'm going to stop my screen share and let Emma show us the video about how we can become the controller.
Hi, thanks for tuning in. My name is Danny Smith from Sage Automation, and this is MV Arcade. You are the controller. So the problem that we're looking to solve straight up is that with COVID being the devastating pandemic that it was last year, visitors into Melbourne are down, and that means spend in local retail and hospitality is also down. So we've come up with a really exciting solution to drive people back into Melbourne, and then when they're in Melbourne, also support local business. So what is the solution? MV Arcade, well, as we've got on the screen here, what we're going to do is use your physical location on a playing field and digitally represent you up on a large screen, and you can then interact in real time with what's on the screen. So the example that you're looking at now is two people playing Pong, and as they move around the physical location, they can bounce the digital ball back and forth between each other. So you are the controller. Now, the way we do this is by mounting machine vision cameras high up over a space, and we digitally represent your physical location up onto that space. So we can map people as they walk around that physical space. Now, we put a lot of time and effort into the solution design for this to make sure that it's very intuitive. We're not going to have any special instructions or reading to be able to interact and play with this experience. Games like Snake and Pong will be very intuitive. You can just jump in and play straight away. We'll also have Indigenous art exhibitions and simulations where you can move through the playing space and different colors and things will happen around you as you interact with that digital environment around your body. We've also put a lot of time and effort into a business hub where local businesses can opt in and offer promotions and incentives for the users of this game to then drive them from completing the game to local business to help drive that economic growth. We'll also develop new models that help pick up wheelchair and ambulant users so that we can pick up everybody, because these don't exist currently and they'll be available ongoing. And finally, we'll get some real data insights into how people play and how they interact, how they spectate, and how often they stick around for and what we get out of that. So we'll get some real good insights on how people interact and how they participate socially. Now, why are we confident we can deliver this? Sage Automation, we've already delivered a lot of experiences exactly like this. We've done the Matilda Transit Hub, which is a universal access solution around transit. We've also done work with Royal Botanical Gardens here in Melbourne. Swinburne University, you know, a global institute, they also have a lot of work and a lot of experience in game design, in user interface, in data insights, and we're going to also use their art students to help us with some of the game design and artistic expressions. Finally, Nucon, also a leader in machine vision and automation. They've got some great solutions in the recycling space that we can leverage to get great outcomes here as well. So what's the benefit? This is truly a world first. This hasn't been done anywhere else in the world before, and it's going to drive a lot of enthusiasm. We're going to get a lot of word of mouth, a lot of social media, and even mainstream media attention from this. With all that attention, we're going to drive people back into the city. This is truly a universal experience though as well, a universal access experience. So any age, any ability, education or language, you can jump off a plane and play this straight away because there'll be no kind of special need or instructions to play this. Also, it's 100% free, so anyone can play this as well. Now, we talked about the business model at the end where people can then opt in, and we believe that when people come in to play the game, we'll then be able to offer free promotions for local business to help drive that economic growth. We will have the new machine models that are available to everybody through City of Melbourne or Swinburne, and we'll get that real data insights into how people, you know, socially interact with this experience. So what we have here is something that we're really excited about. We know that we're really excited to get this off the ground. Our kids are already quite excited, and we know that families are going to love this. We also tick 6 of the 7 aspirational goals from the City of Melbourne, and we know that we can also develop some climate change experiences once we've implemented as well. So we're really excited about this. We hope you are too. Please feel free to reach out if you have any questions, and we'll be sure to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that pitch, Danny. And, you know, I think for many of us that sort of intuitive gameplay is definitely appealing, especially those of us who don't understand how to do the thing. Okay, so I'm going to throw to our wonderful judges for some questions about this particular pitch, MV Arcade. So I'm going to throw first to Juanita. Would you like to unmute and ask Danny a question about his pitch?
Yeah, first of all, congratulations on putting the pitch together. I've been an entrepreneur myself. I understand the amount of work that goes into that. You talked about, you know, it being intuitive and capturing data. And you also mentioned universal access. Okay. And I was wondering about those that have varying visual needs and requirements. What capacity are you providing for those individuals? And you also talked a little bit about climate change as well. So could you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, sure. So around, the vision impaired, so we'll have the screen instructions or the screen interactions are very physical. So it's more about moving your body around a space. Things will also be large enough that people with some vision will hopefully be able to see there. I guess one of the scalability options into the future will be adding a sound system. So there's already speakers, but a better sound system so that we can kind of locate the different, activities that we play there as well. So that as you move through the space, the sounds will change and we can try and work with Swinburne University about where games like Pong could also be using a ball or a sound to track the ball through as well. Sorry, what was the second question?
Yeah, you mentioned climate change.
Yeah, sure.
integrated in. So if you can unpack that very quickly.
Yep. So the other part to the scalability of this solution as well is that once we've designed the machine learning models and we can pick people up, we can then design any experience to then suit. So we can add additional games from the arcade kind of realm. We can also then add different experiences that as you move through the location, the physical location, we can, I guess, change what happens as well. So we've got some ideas around climate change where, you know, maybe there'll be a forest and as you move through the forest, it cuts them down and then we can see temperatures rise. And as you move through waters, it pushes them back and those type of things. So to be honest, we haven't developed them yet. We didn't have it in, I guess, the budget and the time frame to do it for this, but as you know, it's implemented, that's something that we'll work with Swinburne University closely to develop.
Thank you, Danny, for answering that question, and Juanita for some really probing insights there. Great question. Now, Michelle, I think we have time for a quick one from yourself. Did you have a question for Danny about MVRcade?
Yes, thank you, Jeanette, and thank you so much, Danny. That's a really exciting proposal. Who will be providing the tech support if something goes wrong? And how will you know if something's gone wrong?
Yeah, sure. So Sage Automation, we're a national company, but here in Victoria, we've got 70 staff. 12 of those staff are service technicians. So they are A-grade electricians. They all have a van and a car, and they work on control systems and technology like this all the time. So we have a 24/7 national phone line, and you can call that at any time, and then they can turn up to site. So, you know, our office is here in Port Melbourne, so we're only a short distance into the CBD anyways, but we've got those 12 guys that are on call, and they can certainly support this solution ongoing.
Thank you, Danny, for answering that question. And I really like, Michelle, you're all about the doability. What happens if something goes wrong? How do we fix it? Nice one. Danny, did you want to make an impassioned plea to the audience about why they should be ticking MVRcade when they vote?
Yeah, sure. I guess just to summarize, and similar to the video, we're really excited. We think this is a great family experience that will actually drive people into the city. We've got a great marketing team, and you know, we can push this onto the national news, which will then help drive business. So hopefully, yeah, you can get excited about this too. We really think it's a good solution to drive that economic growth. And like I said, feel free to reach out if you have any questions, and hopefully you can vote for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thanks to our cameo appearance from the audience member. Nice to see you there. I think I'm going to just take a pause here because we've actually just had three amazing pitches. Obviously, MVRcade, where you're the controller, social spaces, looking at how we can kind of create these public spaces that are safe and inclusive, and knowledge that shapes Melbourne using the data and the storytelling that's with all of our incredible knowledge institutions. So I'm really keen to hear from the audience. Drop in the chat, what's captured your imagination? Are you excited about the Triceratops? Do you want to get in there and play Pong? Are you wanting to see incredible furniture coming up in your public spaces? I'd love to just hear from the audience in the chat when you get a moment. So do that as we move on to our next incredible finalist. I had the pleasure of meeting Rachel Kaplan during my work over in Tel Aviv. So Rachel, it's wonderful to have you and your team, Esther, Ido, and yourself as part of Sage. Who says money can't buy life experience? Now, all about connecting older folk and their wisdom to schools and workplaces. I'm going to stop the share and Emma, let you take it away with that incredible pitch video.
Sage is the world's first gig economy platform for retirees, offering personalized and affordable learning and social experiences that are hosted by expert retirees. It's a great way to meet new people, learn new skills, and importantly, to reimagine a far more financially stable and fun retirement. Melbourne has been through its tough time this past year or so, like many other parts of the world, and the toll of extended lockdowns and no more life as usual has impacted everyone, but no group more so than the elderly. Financial insecurity, loneliness and isolation, and the usual retirement blues have run even more rampant than ever before. Because the truth is that even before COVID, the system and the structure of retirement as we know it was broken. One third of Australians aged 65 plus are at risk of poverty. People aged 75 plus are the highest risk of loneliness among any other age group, and of course all of the other associated health risks that come with it. And people who no longer work have a 40% greater chance of depression. As life expectancy increases and the cost of living continues to increase, retirement as we know it is simply not inclusive for everyone anymore. And this is why we built Sage. It's a proactive solution for older people to monetize really valuable life experience, knowledge and skills. Freelancers or gig economy workers are the fastest growing work category in the world. And we're making the gig economy accessible for retirees, which is the fastest growing demographic in the world. Sage is a platform that is designed with user-friendly features. We use cutting-edge technology to deliver a convenient, digital, and personalized learning experience. Our CTO is a graduate of an elite intelligence unit here in Israel, and this really helps allow us to deliver the best experience possible, both for the retiree hosts and for our young users. So far, we've hosted over 500 sessions, from cooking classes led by a Moroccan grandmother to chess taught by a Russian grandmaster and everything in between. We have Sage's coaching users on how to build a nonprofit, how to budget better, how to deal with parenting challenges. These are the life skills that we always presumed money can't buy. But with Sage, we're trying to bring this life experience to you in a way that's interactive and in a way that also helps the retirees to earn a bit of extra income and enjoy more purpose and connectedness in their golden years. As much as we are very much a disruptive and fast-moving tech startup, we're guided by a true north, and that is to build a company that will create opportunities and improve the quality of life for our elderly. We believe very much in using and repurposing existing resources and infrastructure and building partnerships that will help achieve our goals and to really deliver on impact. So for example, we're working now with the city of Tel Aviv, and in this project, we're working with 200 retirees living on welfare over a period of 2.5 years, and we're challenging ourselves to reduce their loneliness by a massive 20%. Because part of our vision and our mission here at Sage is to change the conversation around aging, to view retirees as a resource that we can learn from, and this will really help make the golden years a lot more golden. This is something that we believe should not just be embraced, but taught as well. Which is why, if we were lucky enough to be chosen for the City of Melbourne Challenge, this would be the first city in the world to experience Sage for Kids. Sage for Kids is our plan to bring an affordable and meaningful extracurricular activity to Melbourne kids and to their busy parents. Australian households are spending every year $3.8 billion on after-school activities. Sage for Kids would facilitate, at first online, but eventually in person, sessions for kids to learn from local retirees. So we would find Melbourne retirees with a certain area of knowledge or expertise, really anything under the sun, and match them with Melbourne kids who have an interest in learning that particular skill or whatever it is in a fun and a safe way. So many of you will have watched the ABC show, Old Age Home for 4-year-olds. The results weren't just incredibly heartwarming, but there was clear evidence that these connections vastly improved the older participants' mental and physical and emotional health, but at the same time, the cognitive and the emotional development of those kids were through the roof. So Sage for Kids would be a citywide version of this concept, and it's focused on learning and skills. And it's open for kids of any school age. So Melbourne would be a testbed for this new product feature on the Sage platform, and we really can't think of a better place to roll this out than the most livable city in the world. And really, we hope to be able to introduce you to this win-win-win initiative.
Thank you so much, Rachel and team. So once again, Rachel Kaplan, Esther Hershkovich, and Ido Kissos, the team for Sage. Now, in a year when we have been, you know, seeing our older generation really, really lonely and isolated, what a fascinating idea. So I'm going to start with Imogen as our wonderful judge to ask a question. Imogen, would you like to ask a question of Rachel?
Yes, absolutely. Thanks, Rachel. That the idea of a gig economy for, I think, older adults is really exciting and innovative. I'm interested specifically in understanding how you would assess the impact of this initiative. How will you know you're succeeding in your ambition?
That's a great question. I'll answer that based on the project. We're working with the city of Tel Aviv now, just as something that's sort of comparable. We've actually partnered through that with an organization, Social Finance, and what they do is they apply very strong scientific methodology to assess loneliness and economic stress among older people so that we're able to measure before and then after how the impact of the project has been. So there are many different ways to do that, and we'd be happy to sort of talk to you about what those different methodologies are, but we are very much a data-driven organization, and through that we do need to be able to assess whether we've succeeded, and if so, to what extent. So that's something that we build into the projects that we do.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel. And a question, Imogen. I'm going to ask Liam if you have a question for Rachel and the idea that they put forward.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Rachel. Great presentation. So I'm father of a six-year-old who keeps making cameos, you might see every now and then, but so interested in the Sage for Kids. Can you just, is there anything, have you kind of thought about like, I guess, participant screening or any way of kind of adding safety into the experience. Can you just talk us through that a little bit?
Absolutely. And that's a huge, anything that brings people face to face is security and safety is a huge concern and a big consideration. The same way that when platforms like Airbnb or Uber first came about, these are the measures that have to be implemented, have to be part of the strategy from the very beginning. So we're very much aware of that. In terms of the first initial sort of online offering, of course, there would be a SAGE person from the team observing and being part of all of the classes, and we are actually onboarding retirees who are happy to help and are also joining our team to really help and make sure that all of the sessions are being observed, being supervised in a safe way. And then we actually gave some thought, what about when these activities are hopefully able to move in person? Because there's a safety consideration, not just for the kids, but for the older people as well. So Sarah Fyatt, who's another finalist here, we're actually in discussions there on some sort of joint partnership. We're actually able to partner together where the spaces that they're hoping to repurpose can actually serve also as a physical venue for these interactions to take place, sort of a win-win. And then it also makes it a lot easier for the people on the ground to, as I said, observe, to take part, and to make sure that everything done is not just fun, but it's in a safe and a supervised way as well. And that's something, of course, we'll be happy to work with, you know, the people on the ground there to make sure that it is absolutely a pillar of what we would be trying to achieve.
Thank you, Liam. Thank you, Rachel. Now we have, because you're so efficient, we've probably got 60 seconds for another quick question. Aisha, did you have a question for Rachel at this time?
I did actually have a question. My initial thoughts on it was that it was a fantastic idea given the, you know, the ABC documentary that they referenced, which I absolutely loved, and the intergenerational learning. My question, I guess, is, again, around the safety and the regulatory requirements, you know, it gets very complex when you're dealing with children, especially. How is this solution going to address that?
Sure. The other thing that we've also considered is actually bringing the retirees that can go through all of the necessary checks, whether it's a police clearance, working with kids, and we're of course happy to work with any sort of regulatory bodies to make sure that anyone that is interacting with kids sort of passes those basic checks. One partnership sort of avenue that we're exploring is actually partnering with schools and those kind of organizations that we can bring the retirees to the kids, so they're coming to their environment, and again, then there are the teachers and the people on the ground that are able to help and supervise. So anything that we would do would of course tick every box in terms of safety and supervision. So we're open to exploring whichever avenue would suit the needs of the people the most.
All right, nice wrap up there, Rachel. Thank you. And I'm going to give you 10 seconds because we went a little over, but give me 10 seconds on why should we vote for SAGE, and then I'm going to move on to our next incredible finalist.
Sure. I guess one thing that really helps us to stand out when we look at a challenge that's reimagining how physical and virtual spaces in a city can improve and enhance, we're not just looking at the city, we're really looking at the people and the lives of the people and the quality of life that those people are able to enjoy. So we would love to be part of the city of Melbourne.
Thank you, Rachel, and thank you, Team SAGE. Wonderful to have you as finalists in this competition. Now, we're going to move on to our next finalist. Now, as Councillor Lelou mentioned earlier, there's some great data available around parking. And Elizabeth Zealand, founder and CEO of Spot Parking, Spot Cities, thinks that she might be able to do something with that, particularly with her team, Oliver, Craig, Mitch, Javier, and Elizabeth. So very excited to hear how we might be able to snatch back some of our curbside real estate from the car parking, which seems to be having, as you say, an unequal share. So over to you, Emma, to get that video up and running. Thank you.
Hello, my name's Elizabeth. I'm the CEO and founder of Spot Cities, and we've teamed up with Arrivo by RACV and Amazon Web Services to create My Perfect Spot, a project to reimagine curbs for mobility, recreation, and community plates. The curb has many demands, and too often, private single-use parking gets an unequal share. This creates pain points around access, not enough bike parking, not enough freight access, safety, where am I to be dropped off, in my taxi or my Uber, and congestion. 30% of congestion is caused by cars circling for parking. To solve these pain points, we need better curbside information, better curbside analysis, and more equitable access to curbside infrastructure. So how will we do this? Spot cities lead the world in digital collection of the curb. We will map every inch of the curb in a dynamic way by time of day, type of use, be it bike parking, share scooter, disabled parking, commercial loading, pickup drop-off areas, taxi, outdoor dining, the list goes on. And this will be available freely to the community. But this data will also be made available in the Arrivo app, which already provides fantastic multimodal transport information to Victorians. Developed by the RACV, Arrivo is a local app made by Victorians for Victorians that is about to get even better. And the project will use new data, but also existing data, like the in-ground sensors in Melbourne. All of this data and more will be held in the AWS data lake that was built last year for Argyle Park and can help provide a complete picture of citizen use of the curbs. Our project is highly deliverable and scalable. We will deliver in a 3-month timeframe. And as we are innovating using tested technology and trusted partners, this is guaranteed. This is the collection area for the project. This can be easily rolled out to wider Melbourne. So what's our future vision for people using the data? Well, Mary doesn't cycle often, so she was worried where to leave her bike when meeting her friends. Arrivo showed her the bike parking options nearest to where she was going, so she headed into town confident with her choice to cycle. As a transport planner for Melbourne, Simon will have better data and the power of AWS at his fingertips to make decisions on curbside use, such as where to place more bike parking or more pickup and drop-off zones or outdoor parking pop-ups. And he can consult with the community easily. And Oliver is always late looking for parking, but today he planned ahead and with Parking Finder checked predicted occupancy and was right on time. Our project will contribute to Melbourne's goals of industry innovation and infrastructure, sustainable cities and community, and good health and well-being by providing a data-driven view to encourage greener transport, inform decisions to reimagine the curb, and solve the pain points of access, safety, and congestion. And you can find your perfect spot.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for that wonderful pitch and what a creative use of all of the technology that exists as well as technology that is to come. I like how that's a great example of collaboration between Spot Cities, AWS and RACV. Now I'm going to throw to Juanita for the first question on this particular topic. Juanita, would you like to ask a question of Elizabeth, both Elizabeth Zealand and Elizabeth Kim?
Yes, hi, congratulations and well done on your wonderful pitch and what a fantastic idea and initiative. I wanted to ask if you can kindly unpack what you mentioned in your presentation, which was around equitable access to curbside data, if you can unpack what exactly what you were referencing to there. And I'd also like you to quickly take us through in the short amount of time that we have how you were being inclusive in the design and delivery of this initiative.
Oh, thanks very much. Well, the equitable access to the curb comes with better understanding what Melbourne has. And as the councillor said, there is a lot of data, but we'd like to package so that the community can very easily find where disabled accessible spots are, where there are safe pick up and drop off areas, work with that information to give the city itself better planning data by pulling all the data they have, the bike lanes, the bike parking, in something that's very visual and tangible. And that is available for free, but it's also going to be available through the existing Arrivo app, which makes the distribution of that data even more attractive. We would like this to democratize the curb in a lot of ways so that decisions can be made to perhaps suggest parking away from the city, and then those last mile mobility solutions and showing where you can leave your scooter or your bike so you're confident in changing your decision to travel by car. Sorry, could you hear me?
Oh yes, just Jeanette's on mute.
That, of course, it wouldn't be a Zoom event if someone didn't go on mute. Sorry about that. Elizabeth, thank you so much for answering that question. Michelle, I'm going to throw to you to ask a question of the My Perfect Spot team. See how curbside might impact the City of Melbourne.
Thanks, Jeanette, and thanks so much, Elizabeth. Great to see you and fantastic presentation. Look, transport tech is a really, really exciting space, and the debate around highest and best use of the curb is one that we face on a daily basis here at the City of Melbourne. I'm really keen to understand, with the new data sets that you'll be collecting, how you address privacy requirements. And where I'm coming from is that if you're going to enter into this partnership with the City of Melbourne, if you're successful, we have all sorts of obligations around privacy impact assessments and so on, which we are required to comply with. Thanks.
The data that we collect is largely all your signage data, and we would use your existing anonymised sensor data. So there's no personal number plates, anything like that collected. We collect the curbside rules and the inventory, and then we have artificial intelligence that translates those into the types of maps that we've shown. We will also be gathering anonymized like bike parking, bike lanes. In our previous collections, we wipe any kind of visual imagery that shows a number plate or a person on during that collection. And we also actually do publish pictures of disabled spots, back to the previous question, so people can see whether they can fit a hoist or wheelchair in the size of that spot. But that's the only actual image that we transpose. So there is no personal data or identifiable data collected or interfaced with.
Thank you, Elizabeth, for answering that question. And it's so great to hear how, you know, ethical thinking has been built in from day one with these projects. And thanks for that question, Michelle. We're going to move on to our, oh, sorry, I didn't give you a chance to do your very quick, why should we vote for My Perfect Spot? Please do give us a little bit of a rah-rah as to why we should tick the box for My Perfect Spot.
Because if you want to see the triceratops, or you want to eat your takeaway on the sidewalk in a park up eating area, you need to find your perfect spot. So vote.
So we need to get into the city somehow and stay there somehow in whatever transportation we chose. Good pitch, Elizabeth. Thank you very much for that. Okay, we are going to move straight along to Microlabs. Sarah Fayed, Smart Cities and Urban Transformation Lead at ACOM, has partnered with Tim Malone, Richard Morrison and Zach Spiktovic to create Microlabs. So very much focused on the job losses that have happened not only in our city but around the world in the last 12 months. Microlabs is very much imagining a street level shop front. So straight over to yourself, Emma, to play that video, and looking forward to hearing more about Microlabs.
Hi everybody, my name is Sarah Fayed and I am the Smart Cities and Urban Transformation Lead at ACOM based in Sydney, Australia. On the behalf of the team and I, I'm very excited to share with you today our concept aims at reactivating ground floor shop fronts through a new paradigm to bring communities back together into the city. We are a team of urban designers, landscape architects, engineers, and technology experts united by a passion and commitment for making cities more livable, inclusive, and sustainable. Melbourne is a city that had once enabled its quietest laneways to voice a globally recognized creative culture. buzzing streets, lively shop fronts with unique and small businesses spilling out to the sidewalks. Today, the CBD is suffering from the devastating effects of COVID-19 lockdowns, with news headlines constantly highlighting the increase in shopfront vacancies and inability for small businesses to survive. Since March 2020, over 50,000 jobs have been lost. That is almost 1 in 9 people affected. On the street, this means more lease signs, vacant shop fronts, and therefore empty streets. So we ask the question, how can we revitalize the city by activating street level through a digitally enabled paradigm to support local businesses and creatives to prosper in an ever-changing environment? To address these challenges, we are proposing a new type of shopfront that supports small businesses, embraces creativity and culture, and empowers the local community to recover and evolve. The solution focuses on providing equivalent access to space and digital resources for displaced and impacted small business owners, researchers, students, artists, and others alike in the community. These spaces will allow for collaboration through informal working, workshops, exhibitions, and other similar activities while being flexible to respond to the community's changing needs, desires, and aspirations. These digitally enabled spaces called microlabs reimagine the street level shopfronts by spilling out to the street and engaging the sidewalks. They are easily accessible within close proximity to public transport and are designed to be flexible indoor and outdoor spaces. Activities connecting between the street and the lab provide shared space for social and commercial exchange, both being technologically enabled and digitally connected. Some of the components include indoor and outdoor Wi-Fi, screens to engage the virtual environment, digital lockers, exhibition spaces, and so forth. Occupancy sensors provide data on the frequency and the patterns of use in order to create a feedback loop for better space management. This prototype can be scaled to create a network of these digitally enabled spaces throughout the city of Melbourne. Instead of being spaces for consumerism, these spaces are places for innovation and social cohesion. The idea to these spaces is their ability to be adaptable to the changing community wants and needs over time. When it comes to tech, democratization to digital access and safety is key to our proposal. We will be using Wi-Fi infrastructure, backhaul fiber connection networks to enable connectivity, while sensors and CCTVs will ensure safety and security of the space and the people and the users. We'll start with identifying the site while working closely with the City of Melbourne. Within the process, we'll be running a series of community workshops to engage the community and work very closely with them. Then comes the deployment of the prototype and the frequent assessment of this in order to scale the typology and roll it out as a network of sites. No doubt COVID-19 has had a detrimental effect in our cities, but it has provided us with a very unique opportunity to test a new paradigm. We truly hope that you can join us in re-energizing and reimagining a stronger and better Melbourne. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. And I'm very much appreciating how you and your team match my dress tonight. I think we've done very well on that particular point. I'm going to ask Imogen if she'd like to ask you a question first. Imogen, do you have a question for this team?
Yes, thank you, Sarah. That was fantastic. I think this is a really good initiative to help reactivate the city centre, and I think it has immediate practical application to help support those impacted by COVID in particular. My question to you is, are you aware if anything similar to this initiative has been implemented successfully within Australia or perhaps internationally? Are there precedents for something like this?
So, yes, thank you, Imogen, for this question. There has been some initiatives, but they've been done in very different forms. So there's the Tech Stop by Google. That's one that has been done on top of providing sort of digital access for people. There's also the WeWork is the best example that we can give with that. But except for this one, it's really looking at the shop runs activities and really looking at moving it down to the shop level so that you can engage the street level. So I would say I would keep those two examples. I would even say that I believe there was the library lounge in Victoria, in Melbourne as well, where there's, you know, the library has all of these collaboration spaces in the city of Melbourne. So this is kind of looking at that as well and taking some sort of lessons that have been done and implemented there and kind of implementing on a sort of a shopfront typology to engage the street.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah, for answering that question, and Imogen for asking it. I'm going to ask Liam Gilligan if you'd like to sort of ask a question of the Microlabs team. Liam?
Yeah, thanks. And thanks, Sarah, for the presentation. So I think this is a really common problem across kind of cities everywhere of how do you get workers kind of back into the CBD. How have you given any thought about how you make that compelling and make kind of the working from home proposition, you know, less compelling, I guess? You know, how do you actually bring people from working from home into this space?
I'm going to allow the space for Tim alone to answer this question.
Scrambles for mute button. Thank you, Sarah. I think that's a really tough question. I think a lot of cities that we've also been looking at around the world are, as you pointed out, trying to answer this question and asking, what is the new role of the CBD? Is it shifting away from, you know, the office type work and slightly more towards, you know, entertainment, arts, culture, more street level engagement? And people who go to the CBD to work, postcode 3000 was a wonderful initiative many years ago to get people to live there, but most of those people are coming from somewhere else. And a lot of them will start to gravitate to work closer to home or in their homes. We understand that. So I think there needs to be a stronger alignment with arts, entertainment, activation. That's the reason why people will come into the office, into this street level location. There needs to be the bump factor. There needs to be a reason for these incidental collisions of people, not physically, of course, but conceptually and intellectually. So there needs to be a different type of attractor to bring people in. Sarah mentioned WeWork. Barcelona a few years ago did a similar pre-pandemic program called Barcelona at 22, which was to draw smaller entrepreneurs into the city with the promise of strong activation strong integration or connection with other like-minded individuals. I think also in and around Parkville and other universities, or RMIT, along the innovation spine along Swanson Street could also be a powerful attractor in this way that you just don't get anywhere else.
Can I just add one last thing as well? I think the idea of digital divide is huge, becoming a huge problem. So I think these spaces, yes, there will be always these spaces at home that you can always kind of relate to, but also there are these spaces where we crave collaboration and just working together. I think the idea of sort of addressing the digital divide through these micro labs will be sort of a really crucial point of getting people back. And also the idea of monofunctional infrastructure or monofunctional, you know, spaces in general is kind of a dying idea. And this is sort of like really repurposing and allowing places to really respond to the wants and needs, changing wants and needs of the community over time.
Right on the button of timer there. Thank you, Sarah and Tim, for those wonderful answers to the questions. I'm going to ask you if you'd like to give us a bit of a, why should we press the button for Microlabs? Tell us what you need.
Thank you. I think one of the things is that, you know, the idea of dying shop fronts is not a new one, it's not a new trend, but it has been exacerbated with sort of COVID-19. I think for us is, you know, we are really using this COVID-19 opportunity to really repurpose and rethink a new typology that's inclusive and moving away from places for just consumerism to places that, you know, all about collaboration and social cohesion and innovation. So we really hope that you can vote for us so that we can work together to build a new, better and stronger Melbourne. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah, for that. Now, can you believe it? We are on to our finalist for the evening. So I'm very excited to introduce this, introduce Culture Quest. Culture Quest is being presented by Lizzie Moriarty, Project Director at NewsRun, with her team, Shani, Olaf and Gary. Again, a great collaboration between Muse.run, Silverwings XR, and One Wi-Fi. So I'm going to let you put that video straight on, Emma, if that's all right, because this is a pretty exciting gamified approach to exploring our city that you're all going to want to see.
Hello, Melbourne, and welcome to Culture Crest. We use digital technology and resources to transform people's awareness of the cities they call home. Our project focuses on two of Melbourne's assets, public art by Indigenous artists, and the culture and traditions of the First Nations. We want to put our technology at the service of the Koori community and artists to tell their own story with full ownership of the meaning, the message, and the content. We are MuseRun, which is a digital learning platform recognized by UNESCO for its educational impact. Silverwings XR, developers of augmented reality and interactive environments, and One Wi-Fi, who provide secure Wi-Fi hotspots in the city streets and parks. And our big wish is to work with the Indigenous communities to put this combination of technologies at the service of their storytelling. Our proof of concept is a digital game platform. It will be implemented in Birrarung Mar. Here we have public art by Indigenous artists, the park itself, which provides a backdrop for the Koori communities to tell the story of their lands. And we can incorporate elements from City of Melbourne's open databases, such as the public art database, street art, monuments and trees, etc. There are three target audiences for this proof of concept: school groups, individuals, and families. And we'll just talk about school groups here. They can engage in a competitive game, for example, a treasure hunt where they might find an artwork or an object or a specific tree and answer a question from the community and win points. This will give teachers the confidence to cover the Indigenous culture because the content is developed by communities themselves. Using data visualizations and augmented reality, the players will be able to go through a portal like this one into the past and see Birrarung Mar and the Yarra River as they were when the First Nations were living there. The budget covers the costs of developing the platform, creating the augmented reality and 3D experiences, and setting up the Wi-Fi infrastructure, and the work of the Koori communities to edit the content into the app. The Culture Quest is scalable in many dimensions. It can be rolled out citywide. We can add layers such as sport or natural history or science. We can work with museums, zoos, libraries, and we can accommodate multiple languages. We will help bring visitors back to Melbourne. This is about making Melbourne into an interactive social space with an activity which draws people in and increases dwell time and spend in local businesses. It's also a sponsorable asset. We want Melbourne's visitors and residents to be able to share the same space and see it from different perspectives.
Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, Lizzie. And what an exciting prospect to be able to go through Birrarung Mar and explore it in a way that we've just never done before. So I'm going to ask Aisha if you'd like to unmute and ask a question of Culture Quest.
Hi, Lizzie, thank you so much for that presentation. My question to you and your team, I guess, is how do you anticipate getting buy-in for the idea around the different sort of market segments that you've identified for this proposal?
Hi, Aisha, thank you. We want to work with Victoria Education Department to connect with schools. The Wi-Fi hotspots themselves will be marked in Birrarung Mar with QR codes, so just people wandering around who have curiosity can hop on and hop off the network. And quite often families do these activities. We found once they've been on a school trip and experienced the game, then they want to go back with their families. And I can hand over to Shani to talk a little bit more about how that happens, how that engages the families. Shani's there.
Yeah, if you can hear me.
To transfer audiences from one point to another, each user can either share the whole experience or parts of it to whoever he wants. And the interface changes according to his profile. So if he's visiting the city center as a student, he'll experience it in one way, and as a family, it will be in a different mode, probably integrating commercial assets as well.
Thank you so much for that answer as well. Apologies, I was just getting a message from the team in the back channels, the magic of online events. I'm going to pass over to Juanita to ask a question of this team Culture Quest. Juanita?
Yeah, hi. I've just got my dog in the background too, in just case he barks. I wanted to understand if First Nations people will be leading or owning this project. You mentioned them as one of the partners, but I wanted to know essentially who is going to be leading this work and owning this initiative.
That's a very good question. Thank you, Juanita. We want to provide the platform for the communities to edit it themselves, put in the content themselves, and tell the story themselves. So that's absolutely the partnership that we are looking for. So we are hoping to work with the Koori Heritage Trust and other organisations that will provide access to communities who want to use this as a way of telling the story of Melbourne before the city was built.
Fantastic. And because you're being so efficient, Lizzie, we have time for one more question. I'm going to ask Michelle if she'd like to unmute and ask a question of you.
Thank you. Really keen, Lizzie, to hear more about your previous experience in deploying experiences like this.
We have experience of doing a city run in Vienna, which again, Shani can talk about in a bit more detail. And we've done muse runs in museums in Italy and in Israel and around the world. But Shani, if you want to add to that, add anything to that.
If I got you right, our experience is mainly with local communities creating their content and uploading them to the platform. It's done mainly in contested areas in Israel where there are mixed communities, and it was done both for touristic purposes and educational purposes, and as Lizzie said, in Vienna.
And maybe Olive, why don't you jump in to talk about the Silver Wings AR experience and VR in Singapore?
Sure. Yeah, about 20 seconds.
That's not long enough to talk about VR and our capabilities, but we have a brilliant company in this partnership, and we have a lot of experience in creating all kinds of 3D visualization solutions. And I think what was indicated in the presentation from Lizzie already, the moving video, the portal, which actually brings you walk into another world, you walk into the past, you can actually experience how that place was like 200 years ago. And that's just one simple example. There are so many other examples that I could mention and how we can use that augmented reality, or bringing the actual artworks that are there, the physical artworks, bringing them alive using augmented reality, using elements of that artwork, for example, an animal, and that animal then presented in an augmented way, and that animal guides you to the next experience. Thank you. I understand I need to stop.
As well as creating amazing innovations for Melbourne, we're also bending time here tonight. 20 seconds is very long. I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I do need to be fair. What I will ask you though, and your team, is if you'd like to give us a final, plead to the community about why they should select Culture Quest as their favourite initiative.
Well, we want to create an asset for Melbourne that will gamify the entire city eventually. And working with communities to tell the story. So if you want to have a really good fun in Birrarung Ma next time you go there, in about a year's time, vote for us.
Thank you so much, Lizzie, Shani, Olaf and Gary. Fabulous imagination capture project. I can already see lots of kids running around Birrarung Ma doing that with their parents. Okay, so believe it or not, that was our final of the 7 finalists in this incredible city challenge. I am so lit up by the idea about the Melbourne ecosystem embracing these innovations using technology. I can already see myself engaging with so many of these projects. So before we vote, I'm going to take some time to just remind you of what we've heard. Take out your pens and paper. I'm sure you've already been making some notes about what you loved, but let's go through what we heard from the start of the evening. So there's firstly the knowledge that shapes Melbourne using machine learning tools, cityscape visualizations, epic storytelling. This is the one with the triceratops. This is the one with the eels. We're reimagining the knowledge that we have in Melbourne and really, really appreciating those many multi-layered stories that we have in our incredible institutions here in Melbourne, really to power the social, economic, and physical life of our city. That's number one. Number two, the wonderful social spaces. So really trying to understand how neighborhoods have been impacted during COVID and how we can change our public spaces to fit a new set of needs, making us feel safer and more socially connected. Piloting a data-driven process to help us, you know, help the community tell them what we need from our public spaces to make it real with some fabulous creativity. Who could forget MV Arcade, Pong and Snake with a twist? So if you're all about moving your body and using your body as a controller, MV Arcade is using their cutting edge technology to digitally represent your physical location within a playing field on a large screen. So you can play these classic arcade games with your body. Ideally, it's going to be 100% free, fun, and I can already see this going viral around the world with people like jumping around on screens. So MV Arcade is definitely one to look out for, as is Sage. So Sage, just to remind you, that incredible platform, a marketplace to connect, you know, the older and wiser generation with the kids of the world, the kids, the schools and the workplaces. Who said you can't buy wisdom? Sage disagrees. So if you think that it's very important to support not just the city, but also the people living in the city and helping to bring social connections through children and the older generation with this gig economy platform, Sage would be the vote for you. Moving on to my perfect spot. So reminder, perfect spot is where if you want to experience the rest of the city, you've got to get there somehow. So we're looking to create a greener, safer and smarter way to use curbs for all sorts of transportation, pedestrians, cyclists, car share, and also outdoor diners to make sure that the curb is used in a way that is fair, equitable and safe and helps everybody find their perfect spot using some great data that exists and data that will exist soon. Two more to go. I hope you're keeping notes. Who could forget, we just heard from Microlabs. Microlabs is all about reimagining that street level shopfront typology. So creating a bridge between the digital divide, creating a digitally enabled space to support those impacted businesses through COVID-19. Very much about embracing creativity and empowering the community to recover while also evolving as well. And last but not least, Muse Run, the world's first gamified city run. Interactive, scalable, competitive, and just helping people, school groups, families, children to see Melbourne through the art of our Indigenous community. So using imagery, connecting with community leaders, and helping to bring to life the area of Birrarung Ma. Now that was seven incredible pitches. Thank you for allowing me to summarize those. I hope I didn't butcher the descriptions of your projects that you worked so incredibly hard on. Just a reminder, everyone who's pitched tonight has been selected from 40, so seven from 40. It's been a very competitive process and they've all gone through an incredible program with City of Melbourne and also the team here tonight. I think we might be ready to do a little bit of voting. How are we looking over there, team?
Ready to vote, let's vote.
Okay, so Emma, I think we can start that poll. And for everyone who's about to see this poll, what we need you to do is select your top three only. So just your top three, and we're going to share the results of the people's choice. Let me see if I can get out of this. There we go. So we're going to select the People's Choice Award tonight, which is kind of the yellow jersey of the evening. And then after that, the community is going to have 2 weeks to finish voting. So your top three only. Will it be my perfect spot?
Are you all about the spaces? Do you want to play some games? Are you into Triceratops? Do we want to support our older generation? Or are we going to check out Birrarung Ma as it was many years ago? I feel like I should be playing game show music. Da, 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 da. And I just want to say, Tegan and team from City of Melbourne, I mean, it's incredible that the community is voting on these initiatives. It's truly a service to your community that you're opening that 20% impact to us. Thank you very much for that.
Thanks, Jeanette. We're super keen. You know, this is a part of our commitment to trust and transparency and building community accountability. So this is just the first of many prototypes of how we can incorporate the community into deciding what we do and how we do it.
Thank you. And you know what? Maybe in the future we'll have more than 20%. Maybe we'll get 100% one day. And also a reminder that all of the founders are here in the room tonight. So if you do have a question that's going to sway your vote between one or the other, you can drop it in the chat and the founders might be able to answer it straight away. All the founders quickly check their chat. Okay, we are going to give you... How many more minutes do we need, Emma? Do we need a little bit more time? Maybe another...
We have 90% of people voted, so if you want to cast your vote, now's the time. We'll give it another 20 seconds.
Fantastic. I just cast my vote, actually. That was very cool. So that's great. Now, what we're going to show you, just to remind you, this is not the final winners. This is just our yellow jersey for the evening, giving us a bit of an indication of who's at the front of the pack as we go into the community voting. Our judges are also going to have some time to collate their responses and vote separately. So we will have a result next month, because voting for the community actually closes at 5 p.m. on the 31st of March. So that is when everyone else has to stop voting. And we also get a chance to share that with our community. So I'm going to let you share that, Emma, with us as to who has... Ooh, it's a pretty even race. There's not much in it, actually, but Knowledge That Shapes Melbourne and MVRK currently in the lead, but just by a smidge, with Microlabs right on your heels. Honestly, teens, this is such an incredibly tight race. I hope you do see the value in, you know, sharing this in your community. You know, everyone from near and far, anybody that loves Melbourne has the chance to have a voice. And for those of you in the community, in the audience who voted, you are actually able to share this also with your friends, family, children, teachers, whatever it might be. Share the Participate Melbourne page with your community and really just encourage them to vote. So before we go into the details of this, I'm actually going to bring up the winning teams to just give us a couple of minutes about what this early lead means to you. So the Knowledge That Shapes Melbourne, would you like to unmute and join us on stage? Just tell us a little bit about what this means to you, Bonnie.
Thank you, everyone that voted for us. It's just a lovely recognition that we all came up with something that kind of resonates with people that you see some value in and that you'd be interested in seeing developed into a project. We think it'll be really great. We've loved working with the partners and really love the idea of revealing these hidden patterns of how ideas shape our city. So we are very excited. And can I please just take a minute to say hello to Teddy? Thank you so much for sitting through this, my lovely boy. I'm very proud of you.
Oh, that's lovely. Thanks, Bonnie. And what a fantastic wrap up there. And congratulations on being one of our winners of the night. The other being MC Arcade. Danny, would you like to jump up and tell us what this means to you?
Yeah, thank you, Jeanette. Yeah, it's really, really exciting. It's nice to be recognised as one of the solutions that, you know, the community got on board with. So obviously not there yet, but hopefully, I guess, both Bunny's team and mine can get across the line at the end here and hopefully, you know, get something really innovative and world first for the City of Melbourne. So thank you, guys.
Thanks, Danny.
Now, can I just say one more thing, Jeanette? A massive congratulations to everyone else that got up tonight. All of the projects are amazing. And we're really honored to be in the group with everyone, and just huge congratulations.
Could not agree more. What an incredible group of projects. Bonnie and Danny, as you said yourselves, you're not there yet. So you got to just, you know, make sure that you're getting your community behind you to continue with those votes. So anyone else who hasn't been in the top two, which there's, you know, as I said, just a couple of percentage points in it, make sure you share this website at Participate Melbourne. I think it's also going to be pasted into the chat. And as I said, voting will close at 5 p.m. on the 31st of March, 2021. So everyone, that concludes our session tonight. I'm very, very grateful that you all spent time with us this evening. We know that you have choices with what to do on your Thursday night, and you chose to hang out with us and listen to some incredible ideas for the City of Melbourne. I also want to say a big thank you to our judges. I will invite you quickly to unmute and maybe tell us what you thought about everything tonight. So I'll start with Michelle. Would you like to share your thoughts from the evening?
Thanks, Jeanette. Oh gosh, that's just so, they're all so exciting and inspiring. So just to again acknowledge everyone's creativity, the tech and data solutions that sit behind your proposals, and good luck with the community voting. Thanks, Jeanette.
Michelle. Imogen, what about yourself? Did you have some thoughts you'd like to share?
Absolutely. I'm just really excited at all these exciting ideas that I didn't know about and, you know, what's coming down the line, you know, in the future. So I just think it's really inspiring to sit here and listen to all these pitches. So well done, everyone.
I couldn't agree more, Imogen. There's a reason I like to work with startups, and it's because it makes me feel young and smart. In the brain, that is, young in the brain. So, you know, really appreciate everyone for all of their intelligence and creativity here tonight. Aisha, would you like to tell us a little bit about what you're thinking here?
Yeah, thank you so much. I'm really, really impressed with how the challenge was interpreted by all of the groups. And I really, yeah, all the best and good luck with everything. And I think Melbourne will be a better place for your ideas. So thank you.
Yeah, it's so true. The citizens of Melbourne already have gratitude to each and every one of you. Liam, you are over in Sydney. You're checking out some of the innovation coming out of Melbourne. What do you think?
Yeah, I was really impressed with the variety and the different angles that everyone's kind of coming from to kind of solve the challenge that was put out there. I think it was really impressive. And a huge congratulations to the City of Melbourne as well for organising this. I think all of the participants were fantastic, and it was really great to see it on.
Perhaps there'll be some projects spanning the two cities, Liam, in the future. I can see maybe your eyes are lighting up at a couple of those ideas. And finally, Vanessa, would you like to share your thoughts on all of our finalists tonight?
Yeah, I just wanted to encourage everyone to keep going with your idea initiative, regardless of whether you win the pitch or not. And I just also want to acknowledge the incredible amount of hard work that you've put in into these pitches and also answering our questions. I just want to say thank you. For your presence, your energy, and for your hard work in creating these solutions and being present and answering our questions today.
Thank you, Anita. Beautifully said, as usual. And speaking of questions, there is actually a question portal on the website. So if any of you in the audience or in the community have questions of our founders and project leads as you go about voting, you can jump on that Participate Melbourne website and ask a question directly from them. Okay. I promise this is the end. I just want to say a big congratulations to each finalist. I want to say a big thank you and congratulations to Phil Orr, Kim Fernandez and Emma Vance Moore from the 25-8 team, as well as Tegan Kopp and Heli Kotasek from City of Melbourne, and all of the people that are working behind the scenes tirelessly to make this event happen. Emerging Tech Testbed Live Pitch Event officially closed. Thank you so much. I'm Jeanette Chia. I will see you in the city.
Yay! Thanks, everyone.
Yay!
Yeah, go on, unmute, make some noise, put some stuff in the chat.
Well done, Jeanette. Well done, everybody.
Yay! Hi, everybody.
Hey.
Good luck.
Congratulations.
Once and onwards. Hey.
This is fantastic.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks so much. Thank That's
you. Hi, everybody.
Thank you.
Evening.
Really enjoyed
Thank
it.
Thank you, everyone.
I'm so inspired right now.
So fab.
Yeah, thank you everyone for coming tonight. I hope you have a wonderful evening. Please do make sure you get back into the city of Melbourne. Activate our shops, activate our restaurants, our bars, our rooftops, our alleyways. We want to see all of your smiling faces in there. Even activate our curbs. Go park everywhere. Do what you want to do. Get into the city of Melbourne and let's bring it back to life in the best way possible. Because, you know, let's face it, Melbourne is a freaking awesome city and we are so lucky to have it. And we're lucky to have the people that support it as well.
Thank you, Jeanette. See you, everybody.
Bye, everyone.
Yeah. Bye, everyone.